No scheme of man can ever pluck us from your hand till you return or till you call us home. Here in the power of Christ we stand. Lord, thank you for the privilege of gathering together, fellowshipping with you tonight. The entrance, Lord, of your word brings life, power, and heal every infirmity. Lord, may your word come with clarity and without any ambiguity. Holy Spirit, have your right of way. You are the author of this world. Amplify it into our being. Thank you, Lord, for edifying your church tonight. In Jesus' name we pray. All right, good evening, everybody. I have the privilege to speak to us tonight. I want to appreciate our Father in the Lord. He is on a mission. You know, we will know that you'll be surprised to hear that pastors also train themselves. Papi has gone to recharge his battery with other like-minded pastors. And so as we pray, just thank God for him. Because when he comes back, he will come firing on all cylinders. Amen? He'll be back by the grace of God very soon. But until that happens, that's why he trained all of us. Any one of you can also minister to us. Because when we fellowship together, we sharpen each other. Amen? Tonight, without much ado, because of time, I want to speak to us briefly about beholding your face or yourself in the Word of God. Keep beholding yourself in the Word of God. Keep immersing yourself. So the title, keep beholding the Word of God. And we'll take our text from 2 Corinthians chapter 3. 2 Corinthians 3, I will deliberately read from 7, but my emphasis will be in verses 17 and 18. So media project, 2 Corinthians, thank you very much. But if the ministration of death written and engraven in stones was glorious, so that the children of Israel could not steadfastly behold the face of Moses for the glory of his countenance, which glory was to be done away, that is to take away by another one, how shall not the ministration of the Spirit be rather glorious? For if the ministration of condemnation be glory, much more doth the ministration of righteousness exceed in glory. All right? For even that which was made glorious had no glory in this respect by reason of the glory that excelleth. For if that which is done away was glorious, much more that which remaineth is glorious. Seeing then that we have such hope, we use great plainness of all, without any ambiguity, we deliver the message of Christ. We are going somewhere. And not as Moses, the Old Testament, the law, which put a veil over his face, that the children of Israel could not steadfastly look to the end of that which is abolished, that is the law. But their minds were blinded. For until this day remained the same veil untaken away in the reading of the Old Testament, which veil is done away in Christ. That has been replaced by a better new covenant. But even unto this day, when Moses is read, the veil is upon the heart of those who read it. That's what he said. Nevertheless, when it shall turn to the Lord, the veil shall be taken away. Now, pay attention. Now the Lord is that Spirit. And where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is a liberty. Verse 18. Next verse, the last verse. Media 18. But we all, with open face, beholding as in a glass, the glory of the Lord, are changed into the same image, from glory to glory. Even as, even as by the Spirit of the Lord. We will use other rendering and then we dissect this verse 18. This is where we will take in our bearing tonight. Amen. So media, please give us amplified. There is something about this scripture. Verse 18. 2 Corinthians 3 verse 18. Media said amplified. Thank you. And all of us, believers, this relates to believers, not people who are yet to believe. As with unveiled face. Your faces are no longer covered. We're talking of spiritual covering. Because we continue to behold. Where? Where? I told us tonight, keep beholding the mirror, the word. He is the glass, the mirror. Praise the Lord. Because we continue to behold in the word of God, as in a word, mirror, the glory of the Lord. We are constantly being transfigured into what? His very own image. In ever increasing what? Splendor, from one degree of glory to another. For this comes from who? The Lord, who is a spirit. So the question is, why should I behold the mirror? Look at the answer there. It is only by beholding the mirror that I am transfigured constantly. So before we, as we start off, who is the mirror? Who is the mirror? Christ is the mirror. The world. Put up John chapter 1, verse 1. John, we want to define that word. When you say Christ, some people are not convinced. John chapter 1, from verse 1 to 3. In the beginning, give us NLT. NLT. NLT quickly. I have too much to say, but we have reduced it quickly. NLT. In the beginning, the world already what? Existed. The word was with God, and the word was God. He existed in the beginning with God. Verse 3. God created everything through him, through the word. That is why we say you must constantly focus, look up on the word. Amen. You understand what we are saying now? So Jesus is the word, is the mirror, is the glass. A believer must constantly behold, look into it. Amen. Give us verse 14. Verse 14. In him was life. And the life was what? As a believer, you don't exist without the life of Christ. He is the life in you. Amen. So tonight we are emphasizing a very crucial point. The point is, a believer is called to behold the world. You are not called to look at things around you. You are not called to be distracted or to dwell or analyze the changes around your environment. No. Look into the world. You ask yourself, why should I be looking into the world? Because you are no longer of the world. You are of the world. Two words there. You are no longer of WORLD. You are now of the WOR. Why? Because verse 17 tells you that. Look at verse 17. Go back to our text, 2 Corinthians, please, chapter 3, verse 17. 2 Corinthians 3:17. Media. Now the Lord is that spirit that you are born of. And where the spirit of the Lord is, there is what? Liberty. Praise the Lord. So we are emphasizing that world is Christ. Focus on him. Amen. Let's look at another scripture so that we can flow with that. So we are called to behold Christ continually, habitually. We are called to focus on Christ, the world, the mirror, the glass, habitually, consistently, constantly, and progressively. A believer cannot live anyhow. You'll be surprised to hear that. Paul said, I'm a born servant of Christ. When you have freedom in Christ, it means you are tied to Christ. You are inseparable from Christ. That's how we say, so, kati, so. What Christ is who you are. So you must focus, behold the world. It is very important we make this point. Now, why must we say that? Because of Ephesians 2:18. So open your Bible to Ephesians 2:18. We use scripture to explain scripture in Vinefield Church. Amen? Amen. For through him, that is why you must behold the world. Behold Christ. Behold the message. Behold the word he has given to us. He said, for through him we both have access by one spirit unto the, is the gateway to the Father. His spirit and mind are intertwined, and then he leads us to the Father. Praise the Lord. That is the reason why I must concentrate on Christ. My entire being, my focus, my priority should always be on Christ. Why should I focus on the world? You will ask again. Because we are the product of the world. Praise the Lord. Tell yourself, I'm born of the world. I'm born of the everlasting word of God. Okay, let me validate that. 1 Peter chapter 1 verse 25. Quickly. Verse 23. 1 Peter 1 23. Look up. Being born again. The reason why I should focus on the word, I should behold it, is because being born again, not of what? Corruptible seed. But of what? What is that incorruptible? Which word? So using the Kai principle, say that is by the word of God, which liveth and what? Abided forever. That is the more reason. The most important reason, I should focus on it. I should behold it. I should search it. I should continually, habitually. Don't get tired. Paul said, I don't find it boring. I don't find it grievous to emphasize this point to you. Always stick to it. Praise the Lord. Because we are born of that word of God. Give us 25. Verse 25. Give us verse 25, please. Media. But the word of the Lord endureth forever. And this is the word which by the gospel is preached unto you. That is why I should behold it. It endures forever. Bible says, heaven and earth will pass away, but my word will abided forever. I am born of the word of God. It is spiritual sperma that gave birth to me and you. And therefore, all I am compelled to do is focus on that word. Look away from the distractions. Look into the word. It's a glass. It's like a mirror. You ask yourself, why should I do that? Go back to our text. There's something there. 2 Corinthians 3 verse 18. Go back again. It's our focal point tonight. Verse 18, 2 Corinthians. Media, we'll move front up. Yes. It says, but we all, with open face, beholding as in a glass, the glory of the Lord, our world changed. Unless I look into the world, I cannot have the image of Christ realizing me. Look at that. I change into the same image from glory to glory. Even as by this. Give us NLT. So anybody who persistently, consistently focus, behold the world, is changed. It's not like what he was last year. Can I hear an amen? Amen. It is the world that changes you. The spirit quickeneth. The flesh does not profit anything. Amen. Now let's look at this. So all of us who have had the veil. So we know we started from 7. How the law under Moses cast a veil over your face. Spiritual veil. You can't see. You do all the do's and don'ts. The blood of goats and calf. They do all that, yet they cannot. Praise the Lord. But look at this. So all of us who have had that veil removed can see and reflect the glory of the Lord. Can I hear an amen? Amen. And the Lord, who is the Spirit, makes us more and more like him. As you do what? Change into his hair by focusing. As I look into the scripture, as I come for Bible class, as I come for prayer meeting, as I travel in the world, I am changed into the image of Christ. I speak the language of Christ. I behave like him. His values become my value. Praise the Lord. That is what it means to behold the world. The more I behold the world, the more I look into the perfect law of liberty, the more I'm transformed into the image of Christ. Hallelujah. Let's see what James tells us about that. James chapter 1, verse 18. There's a way James describes it. The same law of liberty. James chapter 1. Of his own will begat he us with the word of what? Truth. That we should be a kind of first fruits of his creature. You are begotten. You are produced by the word of God so that you become the first fruit of Christ from the womb of his word, resurrection. Can I hear an amen? That is the importance of the word, focusing on the word. I want to say this tonight, and I beseech you, brethren, please improve on your beholding in the world. Because the less you behold, we'll come to that. We'll come to reasons what will happen when you don't behold the world consistently. There are competing voices. There are competing pictures. There are competing news. There are competing words around. But the word of God that gave birth to you and I, that is what we are called to behold. Can I hear an amen?
Amen.
All right, so let's look at another scripture. 1 Peter chapter 1. 1 Peter chapter 1 verse 23. Have I quoted that before? Sorry. James chapter 1, forgive me. James chapter 1 verse 21. Sorry. James chapter 1 verse 21. Go to 21, yes. Wherefore, lay apart all filthiness and superfluity of naughtiness. This is King James blowing grammar. Listen to it carefully. Don't, this scripture is also, you know, you learn also. It said, lay aside. In other words, there are things that we want to distract you from looking into the mirror. Are we together? Lay it aside. All filthiness. You'll be distracted when you want to pray and look at the Bible. The television will come up. You want to watch Z World. The devil will tempt you to say, can't you watch Big Brother, the latest one? You want to read your Bible. You want to look into the mirror. That is the time you say, hey, this is the time you must listen to that news. No. Prioritize your beholding the world. Can I hear an amen?
Yeah.
We must relate the word of God to our daily experiences. It's not rocket. It is reality. He is our reality. Until we get to the level where we become inseparable from him, we cannot experience this transformation we're talking about. From glory to glory. The glory of Moses is behind us. We are in him already. For you to experience his fullness, you must behold the world. You must behold it above other things. Praise the Lord. Look at that. Wherefore, lay apart all filthiness and superfluity of naughtiness, and receive with meekness. What? What are you supposed to receive with? The engrafted word. Holy Spirit has grafted it. You should receive with meekness, with simplicity, with joy. The engrafted word. Which is what? Able to do what? Give us a lighter English. Let me talk the papi. Give us NLT. Give us NLT. Thank you. So get rid of all the fields and evil that locks around your lives. And humbly, so it takes humility to look into the world. Please take note. It takes deliberate effort and humility to behold the word of God. Because like I said, it is when you want to study the world that distractions will come. That is when your phone will ring. That is why even at home, silent, you put it on silent mode when you want to study. And can I tell you one secret? Don't study the Bible using your phone. You can use the Bible to check other rendering. Study the Bible with this real one. Because your phone will ring. It will beep. And you will be tempted to go and look at who is calling you. The moment you change gear, you are no longer beholding the way it's supposed to be. Because it requires utmost work, concentration. Let me give you an example. If we are going to government house or EFCC office, when we go with clients or interview, either you leave your phone in the car or you submit your phone at the gate and they give you a tally. If we, with ordinary human relationship, can hold that degree of respect so that you don't get distracted to business in this world, how much more? The engrafted word that is able to sustain you and transform you from glory to glory. Brethren, it is very important we understand this. Praise the Lord. So say, lay it aside. Put it off. Now let's go to the next verse. Go to we are going to stop at 25. Continue. 22. But just don't just listen to God's word. You must do what it says. Otherwise, you are what? Did you see that? I must focus on the word. What helps me to focus on that word? My habit of focusing it, I realize I must do it. I should not just read it and close it. No. The next verse. For if you listen to the word and don't obey it, it's like glancing at your face in the morning. Just check out yourself. Over how you did. Then you say, look at the next verse. You see yourself, you walk away and forget what you look like. That is what it is when you read the Bible and close it. Praise the Lord. But I like this bet. Look at verse 25. Everybody read, one, two, go. Praise the Lord. King James said, then that person shall be blessed indeed. If you look into the mirror, if you look into that glass, if you look into the world, can you see another word? Can you see another liberty here? We saw this same liberty in 2 Corinthians 3, verse 17. Scripture explaining each other. Praise the Lord. The Spirit of God, wherever is liberty, is the perfect law of liberty. He opens you up to your reality. And you set free. He said, if the Son of Man shall set you free, you are what? Free indeed. Except you study to show yourself approved. You cannot understand the benefits of it. Praise the Lord. Okay. So we have a responsibility towards this word. The question, what is my responsibility towards the word? We've started it already, but that's a question. Very important question. And James has told us that for us not to behave like a forgetful hearer and forget our image, we should constantly do what we see in the world. Praise the Lord. So I'm not supposed only to behold the world. I'm supposed to do the world. Tell a neighbor, I'm supposed to do the world. I didn't hear you. Say, I'm supposed to do the world. Praise the Lord. Okay. So, let's look at something. Another important thing you do as you look into the world and as you do it, that means something is happening to you. And we studied it in growing spiritually. So let's look at 2 Peter 3 verse 18. You are not supposed to be stagnant as a believer. There is something you must do. Any believer who focuses, who beholds the word, and does what the word says you do, something happens. Look at that. By growing grace. Tell your neighbor, growing grace. Who is grace? Who is grace? You are not answering with conviction. Who is grace? So is the word. Grow in the word. Grow in grace. And what? That is in the knowledge of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. So there is a growth that takes place for anybody who habitually, constantly looks into the perfect law of liberty. Those who don't look into it habitually and constantly will not grow. Are you taking notes? Or you are looking at me? I'm looking at you. Because I will report everybody who's on writing to Papi when he comes. Praise the Lord. No, but the key thing, take note of what we are saying. If I don't, look at that scripture. If I don't focus on the word, if I don't behold Christ, which is the word, I cannot grow in him. Beholding him means studying him. Learning more of his word. Align his word to dictate for me how I live my life. My values, my priorities should be directed by the perfect law of liberty. Praise the Lord. So, Peter is saying, grow in that grace. That is the knowledge of Jesus Christ our Savior. You cannot afford not to grow. Tell the neighbor, I cannot afford not to grow. That is why we are in a place like this, where we learn and we grow. So, Colossians 3 verse 1 and 3. This is what a believer is supposed to do. This is my responsibility towards the world. Colossians chapter 3 verse 1. We used to sing it before. There is a song. If he then be risen with Christ, seek those things which are above, where Christ is seated on the right and of the throne of God. Praise the Lord. If he then be risen with Christ, seek those things which are above, where Christ is seated on the right hand of the throne of God. Amen. Verse 2. Look at this. Those, it is only those who behold the word that can set their affection on. See, it's sequential. There's a process, there's a procedure involved. Set your affection on things above, not on things on earth. Verse 3. For you, a believer, you are now dead. And your life is what? Hid with Christ where? You have double divine insurance. Can I just say double divine insurance? For you to enjoy that insurance policy, you must focus on the word. You must set your priorities on things. That is what is the set affection. What takes your direct attention controls you. If the word of God does not occupy your mind, it cannot control you. Something else will control you. So he says, set your affections on things that are above, not things below. Praise the Lord. Give us verse 8. We'll read this scripture for a while. Verses 8 to 10 of Colossians 3. Go to verse 8. Thank you. But now, ye also put off all this. So he's telling you that by studying the word, by beholding the word, it helps you to put off the old nature. If you're a believer and you don't study, and you just go to church, put your hand in your pocket after church and go home, and wait until Thursday without studying what you've been taught, it will be difficult for you to put off anger. They will wrestle against your spirit man. Praise the Lord. You say, already I'm in Christ. How can anger control me? No. We are still here in the flesh physically. The body. Although you are now born of the spirit. It is the word of God that washes you and enables you. Is the enabler. The Holy Spirit will come to that. Because somebody enables you to focus on the word. That is the secret joker. The Holy Spirit. The Paracletus. Your helper. Praise the Lord. But look at that. But now, put off all this anger, wrath, malice, blasphemy, filthy communication out of your mouth. Verse 9. Next verse. Lie not to one another, seeing that ye put off the old man with his deeds. Look at verse 10. And have put on the new man, which is renewed where? This is where I'm coming to. You cannot renew the new man without knowledge of the word. Can we see that there? So, verse 10 is the real thing we are looking out for here. But, I say, and have put on the new man, which is renewed. So, the fact that you are in Christ means you still need to be refreshed. You are a new man in Christ. Renew it. Don't forget that we are human beings. We have a soul. We live in a body. And we have a spirit. Praise the Lord. Your spirit is saved already. Your soul is the battleground. They dictate, the flesh wants to dictate for you. And the spirit says, no, he's a renewed man. I will be in charge. That is the battleground. You must renew it with the word of God. If you don't, you become stale. You know what makes somebody stale? You are no longer what you used to be. For instance, a footballer. I'll be super ego star now. You won't go for training. Then you wake up after 2 weeks and want to enter the pitch. You will collapse there. Praise the Lord. Why? Because you are stale. Or as a lawyer, you've not read new books for over 3 weeks or 2 weeks. And you want to go to court. One small lawyer will just disgrace you. Because you are stale. Your knowledge has become outdated. Praise the Lord. The same thing as a believer. Look at that. And I put on the new man. There is something that renews the new man. Beholding the word. Prioritizing the word. Excavating the word. That's what we do in leadership class here. Those of you who don't come early, by 8 o'clock dot, Papi will stand here and begin to excavate. It's not everybody that hears that one. Jesus told disciples, it is for you to know. Others I speak to them in parable. If you don't come by 8 o'clock, there are things there. I cannot tell my wife some of those because it is hidden from those who are not here. You renew yourself as a worker in the church with mysteries that have been excavated for you. Praise the Lord. Renew it by the knowledge after the image of him that was created. The knowledge you're talking about is about Christ. We have only one message. We have only one word. 2 Corinthians 15, 18, 19. He has committed that to us. For you to even know that message well, you must renew your understanding of it. 2 Corinthians 5. We know 17. Go to verse 18 and 19. 2 Corinthians. and all things are of God, who had reconciled us to himself by Jesus Christ, and had given unto us what? The ministry of what? To wit, for the purpose that God was in Christ, reconciling the world unto himself, not imputing their sins or trespasses unto them, and had committed unto us. Now, how can I hold the word of reconciliation he has committed to me if I don't focus on it? If I don't study it? If I don't renew myself with fresh knowledge of that word? Praise the Lord. Okay, so let's look. Are we getting something? Let's look at verses 16 to 17 of Colossians chapter 3. Colossians 3, 16 to 17. Colossians 3, 16 says, let the word of Christ dwell where? Dwell where? In me. Say in me. No, you are not with me. Let the word of Christ dwell somewhere. Who? Where is it supposed to dwell? And how is it supposed to dwell in you? How can it dwell in you richly if you don't concentrate on it? So let's finish the reading. Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly, in all wisdom, teaching and admonishing one another in what? And spiritual, singing with grace in your hearts to the. It is knowledge of the word that produces psalms and hymns. The kind of song and hymn you sing is defined by your knowledge of the word, rightly divided to you, and you focusing on that. Praise the Lord. That's why we no longer sing certain kind of songs. There are songs you can no longer sing yourself. Why? Because the nourishing of the word has transformed you into a new image in line with 2 Corinthians 3:18. Can I hear an amen? Amen. The transforming process of the word is manifested in your daily lives, in your songs, in your habits, in your priorities. Praise the Lord. People must notice that change, that transformation. That glory that comes by focusing and meditating on the word is something that can be designed. People will see it. It's not hidden. That is why when they saw them in Antioch, they said, these men, they are different. These are Christ-like people. These men have been with Jesus. Praise the Lord. They identified, said, these are Christ-like Christians in Antioch, because something happened to them. The word has transformed them. The glory of the new veil, that has been the old veil having been removed, and a new experience was visible to people to see. Amen? Amen. Next verse. No, we are not going to that place. We stopped at, I told you we'll stop at verse, 17. Why, have you read 17? Media, give us 17. Yes. And whatsoever you do in word or do all in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, giving thanks to God and to the Father by him. Praise the Lord. Quickly, Philippians chapter 1, verses 1 to 4. Philippians chapter 1, chapter 4, 1 to 4. Paul and Timotheus, the servant of Jesus Christ, to all the servants, saints in Christ Jesus, which are in Philippi, with bishops and deacons. No, I said Philippians chapter 4, not 1. Philippians chapter 4 from verse 1. Philippians 4 verse 1, media. Therefore, my brethren, dearly beloved and longed for, my joy, see as Paul describing believers, my joy, my crown, believers. So stand fast in the Lord, my dearly beloved. Keep focusing on the word. That's what he's telling them. I beseech Eudias and beseech Senche that they be of the same mind in the Lord. Verse 3. And I entreat thee also, through yoke fellow, help those women which labor with me in the gospel, with Clement also, and with other my fellow laborers whose names are where? In the book of life. Verse 4. Rejoice in the Lord always, and again I say rejoice. The scripture I wanted to read is Philippians 4, 14 to 15. So forgive me. Give us verses 14 and 15. That is what is relevant to what we are dealing with. What are the benefits of my beholding the word? What are my benefits? Notwithstanding, ye have done well that ye communicate in my affliction. 15. Am I on the right scripture? No, that is not what I want to deal with. Sorry. 1 minute. All right. Okay, give me Ephesians 4. Sorry about that. Ephesians 4, verse 9 and 10. Ephesians 4. Sorry about that. Ephesians 4. Thank you. Now, that he ascended. What is it but that he also descended first into the lower parts of the earth? Question, verse 10. He that descended is same also that ascended up far above all heavens, that he might fill all things. Verse 11, continue. And he gave some apostles and some prophets and some evangelists and some pastors and teachers. Verse 12. There is a reason why these ministries were given to the church. Look at that. For the perfecting of saints, for the work of the ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ. Now, the essence of this ministry is to perfect us, to edify us, to build believers. Do we agree on that? Now, something happens when you are being taught rightly and you continue what you are being taught. Your knowledge is renewed in your inner man. Look at up. Look up. It is only when you do that that you progress till we all come. So, focusing on the word, beholding the word, being taught consistently, and applying what we are being taught catapults us, graduates us to a place when we come to the unity of the faith. And of what? There is a knowledge of the Son of God which you cannot get by casually coming to church. Without on your own focusing on the word, being renewed by the word. He said there's a knowledge of the Son of God unto a perfect man. So it is by looking into the word that perfection comes. Perfection can come from no other place than by habitually, constantly being renewed by the word. Amen. Now there's something very important in this scripture. Look at it up there. Until we all come to the measure of his stature of the fullness of Christ. I want to dwell on this phrase. So you should not be satisfied where you are now. I should not be satisfied that I've attained. No. The question you ask yourself, have I come to the unity of faith first of all? If you say yes, my knowledge of the Son of God, is it okay for me? Paul, after 30 years in ministry, said that I may know him. After 30 years, Paul, that wrote all the scripture, he said he was not satisfied. I don't know him yet. That I may know him and the power of his resurrection. Being made conform to his suffering. Paul, 30 years in ministry, say, no, I've not attained. I never know this man yet. Praise the Lord. So renewing yourself with the world gives you a new knowledge and turns you from where you are to a level of perfection as far as the word of God is concerned. Praise the Lord. Now, unto the measure. So, let's use this pillar as an example. Unto the measure. Let's say, I cannot belittle Christ. But let's say this is the statue. This is Christ. Looking at that scripture. Unto the measure of the stature. So, I was here before. When I became a born again. So, I had to grow from where I am. Christ is colossal. He's limitless. He's infinite. You can't define him. You grow into the stature. So as they measure you, they say, you know the way he used to be before. This man has grown. No, praise the Lord. What grows a believer is the word of God. Praise the Lord. That is the point we have to emphasize. That is the right emphasis. Tell a neighbor, that is the right emphasis. Praise the Lord. Okay, so the word of God perfects us. It puts us united in our faith. And then as another thing it does, Paul, like I was saying, let's look at that scripture. Philippians 3 verse 10. Paul said something striking. Paul was not satisfied that he has known Christ already. 30 years in ministry. Who wrote almost all the books, most of the books in the New Testament. I mean the epistle. Look at what Paul said here. Look up. That I may know him. And the power. So there is something. No wonder he prayed in Ephesians chapter 1 verse 17 that the eyes of our understanding be what? Enlightened. Be flooded with divine light. to see what ordinary eyes cannot see. He said that I may know him. There is a power, the dynamis, the thing. We discussed, we said several things happened in the resurrection of Christ. God tested those powers in him. That's the power that resurrected Christ. That I may know him. And the power of resurrection. And there's a fellowship in his suffering. So, believers who have not grown in the world, they are scared of suffering for Christ. There's a fellowship in suffering. When you mature in the world, you are not afraid or worried about sharing in the suffering of Christ. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. You are excited. Bible says, blessed are you when men persecute you for my word's sake. To be envied are you. According to Amplified. When I say blessed, I say to be envied are you. Paul said there is a fellowship in his suffering for the sake of the gospel. He said he suffered so many shipwreck. He said he turned hunger into fasting. He said he bears in his body the mark of the gospel. 39, they beat him twice, 39 each. He said that is the fellowship of the suffering. What sustained him is the revelation knowledge he got by Christ. Amen. Being made conformable unto his death. The next verse. So he has to, even in death, align himself with Christ. If by any means I might attain unto the resurrection of the dead. Paul never said he has attained. Despite all those accolades, Paul said that I may continue. I want to know this man. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. All right. Please, somebody, who is timing me? But people will say we must be disciplined with time. Amen. 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 All right. So, one of the benefits of beholding the world, which I want to emphasize, Philippians 3 verse 9, quickly. Philippians 3 verse 9. Philippians 3 9. And be found in him, not having my own what? Okay, let me read it and then I will tell you the benefit of that. And be found in him, not having my own righteousness, which is of the law, but that which is through the faith of Christ. The righteousness which is of God by faith. If I don't focus on the world, if I'm not renewed by the knowledge of the world, I will end up creating my own righteousness. My own standard. That is what we have today in religious bodies. The do's and don'ts in various denominations and groups, they create their own righteousness, their own standard, based on the law. Don't forget, we started by saying that the Spirit of God gives us liberty, freedom. So I understand the liberty I now have in Christ when I focus on the Word of God. If I don't do that, I'll be confused by the doctrines of men. And then we will not have the righteousness of men. Instead of the righteousness of God, which is based on faith in the finished work of Christ. Are we together? Are you with me? Praise the Lord. So one of the key things you must know is that if you are not beholding the world, if you are not walking in tandem with the Word of God, you will end up setting up your own righteousness, which is by works, as against righteousness of God based on faith in Christ Jesus. That is what our scripture emphasizes. Praise the Lord. Okay. So, let's look at Romans chapter 10 from verses 1 to 4. I'm running up. Romans chapter 10 verses 1 to 4. Thank you. Brethren, so talking about your own righteousness, Paul has to explain to the church in Rome the kind of righteousness the Jews were practicing, which is not the righteousness of God. Why? Because they refuse to be guided by faith based on the finished work of Christ. Praise the Lord. So for just an example that illustrates what we are saying, the righteousness of men against the righteousness of God based on faith is what this scripture is teaching us. Brethren, my heart's desire and prayer to God for Israel is that they might be saved. Paul was lamenting. For I bear them record that they have a zeal of God. But what? Of what? They have a zeal, but that is not based on the knowledge of the Word of God, which is in Christ. He said, for they being ignorant of God's righteousness, going about to establish their own righteousness. Why? Not having submitted themselves unto what? The righteousness of God. Look at that. Why should I submit myself to Christ? Why should I look into the perfect law of liberty? Why? He fulfilled the law for me. I could not fulfill the do's and don'ts of the law. He said, for Christ is the end of the law for righteousness to who? As soon as you believe, simplicity of the gospel. As soon as you believe, you are carried, translated from the kingdom of do's and don'ts into the glorious kingdom of his dear son, where he enjoys the spirit of liberty in his world. Praise the Lord. No, it's important we put this in context so that we must never be tossed to and fro by every weight of doctrine. That's what the Bible says. If I refuse to focus on the word of God, then people will creep in. Bible says they come in stealthily with slick, cunning ways to deceive. You get tossed to and fro by every wind of doctrine. Anything that comes, because why? You have not taken time to behold the word. Remember James told us, he said, if you just read the word and go home, you are like somebody who just look in the mirror. And straight away, you forget what you look like. In other words, as you go, anybody can tell anything. Say, is it true? Now we know. We learned last Thursday. We now know. Know ye not. Knowing that. We were taught here. Well, how many of us were here on Thursday? So we know. So since you know, I know. Isn't it? So nobody can confuse you. But if you don't know, how do you know? By studying the word. So as you live here, nobody can bamboozle you. That is what Bible calls, so you cannot be tossed to and fro by every wave of doctrine. They are all over there. Put on your TV when you get home, or drive your car from here and put on the radio. You hear different versions. But we have one message. Praise the Lord. We have one Christ. We have one doctrine. We don't have